Welcome everyone to the very first technical session of TQC 2024. That's a great conference that's being organized by OIST and Squid. And we are very happy to have here Tomoyuki Morimai. He has worked on several aspects of quantum cryptography, from verification of quantum computation, blind computation, and clonable cryptography. And now he'll talk about this very interesting hot topic about quantum cryptography without one-way functions.
Okay, thank you, Alex, for the introduction. And also, I'd like to thank the organizer for the invitation. So today I'm going to talk about some quantum crypto stuff, and including our results. And these results are based on joint work with Takashi Yamakawa. Okay. So this is the outline of my talk. So I have three parts. And in the first part, just I give some basics of classical cryptography, because I assume many audiences here are not necessarily familiar with classical cryptography. And then I start the main body of my talk, some new world in quantum cryptography. And then finally, I give some more technical details like PRSG, R1SG, and so on. Okay. So first, I explain some very basics of classical cryptography. So of course, in cryptography, we have security. And mainly, we have two definitions of security. So one is statistical security, which means that this is secure without any computational assumption. So more precisely, actually, this is unconditional IT security. But for simplicity in this talk, just I explain only two definitions. So statistical one, we don't have any assumption. And the other one is computational security. So here we make some assumption that some problem is hard. And based on this hardness, we construct primitives. So this is secure under some assumptions. So we have these two definitions. And of course, statistical security is very strong. Okay, this is truly secure. But unfortunately, this is not always possible. So we already know that statistical security is not possible for many tasks. So that's why we study computational security. And so, of course, this computational security is weaker because we make some assumption. And if this assumption is broken, then security is also broken. So security is weaker. But on the other hand, this is very useful. So as I will explain, many functionalities are possible based on this computational security. And in this talk, I focus on this computationally secure cryptography. Okay. And so in this computational security, of course, we need some assumption. And the question is, which assumption is the most fundamental one? So we have many assumptions. And which is the most fundamental one? And actually, in classical cryptography, we already know the answer. This is a one-way function. One-way function is some function which is easy to evaluate, but hard to invert. And more precise definition of one-way function is the following. So f is some function which can be efficiently computable. And security is defined as the following security game. So we have a challenger who chooses some random bit string x and sends f of x to the adversary. So if we require quantum security, adversary is quantum polynomial time. And if we just require classical security, adversary is PPT, probabilistic polynomial time. And this adversary must return some bit string x prime, which should be a preimage of this f of x. And security means such probability is negligibly small. So except for the negligibly small probability, this adversary cannot find the preimage of this f of x. So this is a definition of one-way function. Okay. And so question is, do one-way function exist? Because this is just assumption. So there is no proof that one-way function exists. So just we assume that one-way function exists. So just we don't know whether this exists. So just people believe this exists. And especially showing the existence of one-way function is extremely hard because if you can show one-way function exists, then we can also show p is not equal to np, which solves the long-standing open problems in computer science. So that's why just we have to assume one-way function exists. And in classical cryptography, we have this zoo. So in the famous Imperglia 5 world, we have three worlds that are related to cryptography. And the lowest one is this Pesci land, where no one-way function exists. So this means almost no classical cryptography is possible. And on the other hand, above this Pesci land, we have mini crypt where one-way function exists. And in that case, we also have many other primitives like pseudorandom generators, pseudorandom function, and so on, which I explain later. And they are actually equivalent to one-way functions. And also, we have another word, cryptomania. Where some more advanced functionalities are possible, like public key encryption, multi-party computation, and so on. And already we have evidence that these two worlds are different. So especially, we will not be able to construct these cryptomania primitives from one-way function. There is some oracle separation here. But on the other hand, these cryptomania primitives imply one-way function. So if they exist, also one-way function exists. So this is a classical cryptography zoo. And now I explain some more details about these primitives. So first one is a pseudorandom generator, which is some a classical polynomial time algorithm that takes n-bit string as input and output n plus 1-bit string. And security is defined as the indistinguishability of the following two experiments. So in one experiment, a random bit string x is chosen, and the g of x is sent to the adversary, QPT adversary. On the other hand, in the second experiment, n plus 1-bit string is chosen uniformly at random, and this is sent to the adversary. And security means they are computationally indistinguishable. So this QPT adversary cannot know whether he gets this G of X or truly random bit string. This is a definition of pseudorandom generators. And now I explain pseudorandom functions. This is some efficiently computable function with key K. And again, security is defined in the indistinguishability of the following two experiments. So in the one experiment, bit string k is uniformly chosen at random. And then adversary can query the oracle that evaluate f of k, sorry, fk of x. So adversary can send bit string x to the oracle, and oracle returns fk of x to the adversary. So adversary can query many times. On the other hand, in this experiment, truly random function f is chosen, and adversary can query this oracle, which evaluates this random function f. And again, they are computationally indistinguishable. So this means adversary cannot know whether he is querying to this pseudorandom function oracle or this truly random function oracle. Okay. And also, I explained secret key encryption. So, sender has key, secret key K, and also message M. And sender wants to send a message, so he runs the encryption algorithm to generate ciphertext. And this ciphertext goes to the receiver. Receiver also has a key K. And she can easily decrypt this ciphertext by using this secret key K. And on the other hand, adversary who can access this ciphertext cannot run this message. So this is a secret key encryption. And one-time SKE means encryption can be done only once. So if you encrypt many messages by using the same key, then security no longer holds. And on the other hand, many times SKE means you can encrypt many times by using one single secret key. And digital signature is the following one. So we have a sender who has a signing key, and he wants to sign some message. So he runs the signing algorithm and generates some signature that corresponds to this message M. Then he sends this message and signature pair. And the receiver who has a verification key can verify that this message and signature pair is valid one. And on the other hand, we have adversary who has verification key cannot forge this signature. So verification key is a public one. So even adversary can get this verification key, but he cannot output message plus some bit string, sigma star, such that this is accepted as a valid pair of message and signature. So no adversary can output valid message and signature pair. This is digital signature. And again, we have, and also if this verification key is a secret one, if this is not publicly available, this is called MAC, message authentication code. And again, we have one-time version and many-time version. So one-time digital signature or one-time MAC means you can sign only once. And many-time one means you can sign many times by using the same signing key. Okay? Okay, and also I explain commitment. So sender wants to commit some bit B. So he computes some commitment and send this commitment to the receiver. Okay. And here we require the property which is called hiding. This means from commitment, value of this bit B is unknown. So receiver cannot learn this bit B from commitment. And later, this sender wants to open this commitment. So he sends committed bit B and also opening information. And the receiver can verify that this is actually commitment of B. And here we require the second property, which is binding. So this means Bob cannot change his mind once he committed. So here, maybe he wants to make Alice open another bit, B plus one, but he can no longer do that. This is binding. And if this binding and hiding are both satisfied, this is a commitment. Okay, and also I explained public key encryption. Here, a receiver learns key generation algorithm to generate pair of secret key and public key. And the public key is publicly broadcasted. And sender who wants to send some message M runs the encryption algorithm to generate ciphertext. And this ciphertext is sent to the receiver. And the receiver can decrypt by using her decryption key, secret key. On the other hand, adversary who can access PK and ciphertext cannot learn this message. So because this key is public, so this is also available for adversary. And of course, this ciphertext is available. But still, from this CT and PK, adversary cannot learn this message. So this is a PK. Okay, and finally, I explain key exchange. This is a protocol between two people, Bob and Alice, and they exchange some message over some public channel. Finally, they share key, secret key K. But adversary, if you can access this public channel, cannot learn this key K. This is the key exchange. And sorry, also, I have to explain multi-party computation. So we have Alice and Bob, and they have some input, X and Y, and they communicate. And finally, they evaluate F of X, Y, and F of X, Y. But each doesn't know the other one's input. This is multi-party computation. So in this way, I explained almost all classical primitives here. Okay, this one. And from this diagram, the most important point is that one-way function is essential. So if one-way function don't exist, all of them don't exist because they are equivalent to one-way function, so they don't exist. And also they imply one-way function. So if one-way function don't exist, they don't exist. So this means if one-way function don't exist, then almost all classical cryptography become impossible. This one. So that's why one-way function are minimum assumption in classical cryptography. And this is a summary of my first part. So one-way function are minimum assumption in classical cryptography. Is that okay so far? Do we accept question? Is there any question? If you have a question, maybe I can answer. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So maybe let's move on to the second part of my talk. Okay. So now I start the main body of this talk. And so first I review this new world. So as I said, in cryptography, we have two security, statistical security and computational security. And so question is, what happened in quantum cryptography? So far I have explained only classical one. So this is post-quantum or quantumly secure crypto, but still this is classical crypto. And now I explain quantum one. And the question is what happened in quantum case? So this means we can do quantum computation and also we can use quantum communication. And in this case, how this changes. And actually we already know that we have statistical secure key exchange is possible. This is just a QKD. So maybe you might think that in quantum case, everything can be done in statistical way. So every crypto is possible just in statistically secure way. And that's why computational secure crypto is useless in quantum case. So you might think that, but actually this is not correct. Because we already know that the statistical security is impossible even quantum case, or just we don't know how to achieve that in quantum case. So for example, digital signature, this is clearly impossible to be done in statistical secure way because verification key is public. So adversary can learn verification algorithm. So just adversary can learn verification algorithm exponentially many times to find valid signature. So that's why adversary should be bounded. And also old two papers already showed that commitment, statistical secure commitment is impossible, even in quantum case. And also we know that classical verification of quantum computing is possible if we assume, for example, the hardness of LWE, as is shown by Mahadev. But it's still open whether we can construct statistically sound classical verification quantum computation. So in this way, statistical security is impossible or we don't know. And that's why a computationally secure crypto is important even in quantum case. Okay. And so in this talk, I focus on this computationally secure quantum cryptography. And in this case, again, we need some assumption because this is a computational one. And again, question is which assumption is the most fundamental one? So in classical case, I already explained that one-way function is a minimum one. Now, question is, what happened in quantum case? So maybe again, one-way function. So quantumly secure one-way function. But actually, this is no. This is the main result of this talk. So in quantum world, even if one-way function do not exist, still cryptography is possible. Okay? So now I explain more details about this. So this is a classical picture. So we have PCLand, MiniCrypt, and also CryptoMania. And this is just all in classical case. But in quantum case, in between MiniCrypt and PCLand, we have another new world, which could be called MicroCrypt, because micro is smaller than mini. Okay? And this, in this new world, we have new primitives, like EFI pairs or PRSG or OneSG, which I will explain later. And they seem to be weaker than one-way function. So Kretschmer showed that they could exist, even if one-way function don't exist. So they could be weaker than one-way function. But still they imply many useful applications, like commitments, secret key encryption, digital signatures. So from these very weak primitives, still we can construct many applications. And even multi-party computation, because in quantum case, we can realize multi-party computation from commitments. So in this way, in quantum case, now we realize that there is another new world, and from these primitives, we can realize many applications. Okay, and this is just a summary of all known results so far. And now I explain more details about this, but this is just a summary. And also you can see this web page where you can find some very nice diagram. Okay, so now I start part three. Is there any question so far? Then I start the final part of my talk, which is some technical details about this micro crypto world. So again, this is just an overview of all known results. And first I explain pseudo-random unitary introduced by Zhenfeng Ji and Liu Anderson. And this is a quantum analog of pseudo-random function. So this is some efficiently implementable unitary with some key K. And securities are again defined by the indistinguishability of two experiments. So in the one experiment, key is chosen, and then adversary can query oracle that apply this unitary. So adversary sends any quantum state to the oracle, and oracle apply this UK on given state. On the other hand, in the other experiment, just how random unitary is chosen. And adversary can query oracle that apply this how random unitary. Okay. Now, of course, adversary can query many times. And again, they are computationally indistinguishable. So adversary cannot know whether he is querying to this PRU oracle or how random oracle. And PRU can be constructed from one-way function. Actually, this was an open problem, but recently, Huang and Fermima showed that one-way function implies PRU. And as far as I know, this is not yet published, but you can see their talk at Simons Institute. And also PRFSG, which was introduced by Plum Van Janans, Rowan Kian, and Henry Yue. This is a quantum analog of PRF. So this is some QPT algorithm that output some quantum state on input key and classical bit string. And security is defined as the following indistinguishability. So in the one experiment, the key is chosen first, and then adversary can query oracle that evaluate this algorithm G. So adversary can send classical data to the oracle, and oracle returns phi k of x. And in the other experiment, Just adversary can query any bit string to the Oracle, and Oracle choose her random state and returns this state. And later, if the same X is queried, the same state is returned to the adversary. But if adversary send another bit string, Y, then Oracle again choose her random state independently and return that state. And again, security is their computational indistinguishability. So adversary cannot learn whether he is querying to this PRFSG Oracle or her random state Oracle. And PRU imply PRFSG. And also I explain UPSG, unpredictable state generators. This is a quantum analog of unpredictable function. So this is again some QPT algorithm that output quantum state on input key and bit string X. And security is defined in the following game. So first, key K is chosen, and adversary can query this oracle. So adversary send bit string X, and he gets quantum state. And the goal of adversary is to output some bit string X star and some quantum state. And this X star shouldn't be queried before, because otherwise this is trivial. So this X star shouldn't be queried before. And this row should be close to this state, phi k of X star. But security requires this is impossible. So this means adversary cannot predict output of this G. And PRFG imply UPSG, and also UPSG has have applications like many time SKE and MAC. So far we have this picture. So one way function imply PRU, and PRU imply PRFSG. And PRFSG imply UPSG, and UPSG have applications. Okay? And even at this stage, we have many open questions. So for example, so here we know that the PRU can be constructed from one-way function. But the question is there any some genuinely quantum assumption that imply PRU but will not imply one-way function? So we want some genuinely quantum assumption that imply PRU but that will not imply one-way function. And some folklore says that random circuit is one example of PRU, but as far as I know, there is no proof. Okay, and second question is whether PRFSG imply PRU or not. And also, we don't know whether UPSG imply PRFSG. So in classical case, actually, they are equivalent. So in classical case, we have UPF, unpredictable function, and all the paper by Naur and Reingold showed that they are equivalent. So PRF and UPF are equivalent. But in quantum case, we don't know whether they are equivalent. And also another my open question is whether any some major application of PRU, cryptographic application of PRU, not possible with PRFSG. Because many major applications like many time MAC or many time SKE are possible with just PRFSG. So just I want to know any some application PRU. Okay, and I also explain PRSG, pseudo random state generator, which is a quantum analog of PRG. So this is some QPT algorithm that output quantum state on input K, key, and security is just a computational indistinguishability of the following two experiments. So in the one experiment, key is chosen, and T copies of phi K is sent to the adversary. And in the other experiment, just her random state is chosen. And T copies of this her random state is sent to the adversary. And security means for any polynomial T, they are computationally indistinguishable. So adversary cannot know whether he gets T copies of pseudo random state or T copies of her random state. And the point here is this is for any polynomial T. Because if this T is decided in advance, in this case, just T design is enough for that goal. But the point here is this T is unbounded polynomial. And for special case, when T is equal to 1, this is called 1PRSG. So in this case, only single copy of pseudo-random state or half-random state is given to the adversary, but the adversary cannot distinguish them. Okay. And PRFSG imply PRSG, and also PRSG imply one-time SK. And also I explain private quantum money. This is consists of some algorithm. So first, mint algorithm is run that output quantum money state on input key, classical key. And then challenger choose K first and sends T copies of money state to the adversary. And adversary must output some quantum state that consists of many registers. And challenger check each register by running the verification algorithm. And challenger counts the number of acceptance. And if that number is larger than T, this means that the adversary can forge money. So because he gets T copies of money state, but finally he could output more than T copies of quantum state. And security means this is impossible, except for negligible probability. And PRSG imply private key quantum money. So now we have this picture here. So we have PRSG and PRSG imply money. And also PRSG imply one-time SK. And one open question is whether they are equivalent or not. So in classical case, actually they are equivalent. So from PRG, we can construct PRF. This is some typical textbook result. Just from PRG, you can construct PRF. But in quantum case, we don't know how to do that. And also, we don't know whether private key quantum money imply PRSG. So this means, so this direction is easy. So pseudo-random state is unclonable. This is okay. But the other direction is not clear. So whether unclonability implies pseudo-randomness or not. And also this is unclear. So from one PRSG, can you construct PRSG? Many copies secure PRSG. And actually about this one negative result was obtained recently. So they show that relative to some oracle, one PRSG exists, but poly PRSG do not exist. This means this direction is impossible. Okay? But this doesn't completely answer the open problem. For example, because their oracle is a common Hall state oracle, which means oracle output Hall random state. And what you prohibit is only black box construction decided by this type of isometry oracle. So there still there could be some another way of black box construction of many PRSG from one PRSG. So still this doesn't give the complete negative answer to the open problem. Okay, and also another interesting question is whether we can construct one-time SK from one PRSG. Okay. So this is one-time SK. So this means you can encrypt only once. But interestingly, still you need many copy PRSG. Actually, this construction is not so trivial. They do some nice technique. And although this is only one-time security, you need many copy security from this one. So question is whether you can realize one-time SK from single copy PRSG. And also this is another open question. So whether they are equivalent or not. So unclonability imply encryption or encryption imply unclonability. Okay. And also another interesting open question is whether we can extend the output of PRSG. So in classical case, output of PRG can be extended. So if you have some BRG that extend only one single bit, then you can get any PRG. that has any extension. But in quantum case, we don't know how to do that. Okay. And so now I explain a quantum version of one-way function, which is called the one-way state generator. And this is just a QPT algorithm that output quantum state on input key. And security is defined in the following way. So we have a challenger that chooses key K and sends T copies of phi K to the adversary. Then adversary must return some bit string K prime, which should correspond to some pre-image of this quantum state. So challenger runs the verification algorithm and accept or reject. And the probability that challenger accept should be negligibly small. This is a quantum analog of one-way function. Okay. And private quantum money with pure banknote imply one-way state generator. And also one-way SG is equal to one-time secure digital signature. And also one-time SK imply one-way state generator. So now we have this picture. So here, if this banknote is a pure state, we get one-way SG, which is equivalent to one-time digital signature. And also one-time SK imply one-way SG. So we have this picture. And again, we have many operations. So for example, can we show this direction? So this direction is easy because if you can invert, you can get the key and you can clone. But the other direction is non-trivial. Even if you can clone, this doesn't necessarily mean you can find the key. So that's why this is non-trivial. Okay. And also question is whether we can construct many times secure digital signature. So in classical case, again, if you see any standard textbook, you can see that many times secure digital signature is possible from one-way function. So first you can construct one-time digital signature, and then you can convert this into many times secure digital signature in classical case. This is a very standard textbook result, but in quantum case, we don't know how to do that. And actually, recently, one paper gave some negative result. So they show that relative to some oracle, actually this is a Kretschmer oracle, some type of many time digital signature is impossible, although PRU exists. So somehow this gives a negative answer to this open problem. But this doesn't completely give the negative answer because, for example, this signature is classical. So what they prohibit is quantum public key, classical secret key, classical signature, many time digital signature. And if this signature is quantum state instead of classical data, in this case, we don't know what happened. Their result is not applied. And also there is some paper that show possibility of getting many time security. So they show that from log output PRSG, so this is just a PRSG, but output quantum state is only log qubit. And from this log output PRSG, you can construct many time digital signature. Okay. And again, this doesn't completely answer the open question. So I will explain this more details about later. But actually, this log output PRSG seems to be slightly different from this all primitives below PRU. Okay. And also, I explain one-way puzzle. This is introduced by Kraner and Thoma. And also, tomorrow's Dakshita talk, she will give some more details. So this is some pair of sampling algorithm and verification algorithm. So the challenger runs the sampling algorithm to get two classical bit strings, puzzle and answer. And this sampling algorithm is a quantum polynomial time. And this puzzle is sent to the adversary, QPT adversary, and the adversary must output some bit string, answer prime. And then challenger runs the verification algorithm and accept or reject. And actually this verification algorithm is unbounded one. So this is not necessarily QPT. And then security means probability that this is accepted is negligibly small. This is also considered as another quantum version of one-way function. Okay. And also you can see some more details in tomorrow talk. And also EFI, which is introduced by Brakelski, Canetti, Kian. This is some two quantum states, efficiently generatable two quantum states that are statistically far, but computationally indistinguishable. So their trace distance is large. So in principle, you have some measurement that distinguishes these two states. But computationally, you cannot do that. So any quantum polynomial time algorithm cannot distinguish these two states. And classically, this classical analog was already introduced by Goldreich, which is called EFID. So this is some efficiently generatable two classical distribution that are statistically far, but computationally indistinguishable. And he showed that this is equivalent to one-way function. So in classical case, this is equivalent to one-way function. And this EFI, quantum version, EFI, is equal to commitment. And also, a one-way state generator imply EFI. This was open problem, but recently two papers showed that actually one-way state generator imply EFI. So now we have this picture. So from pure one-way state generator, we get one-way puzzle. And from one-way puzzle, we get EFI. Or the second paper directly show that even mixed one-way SG imply EFI. And EFI is equivalent to commitment. And commitment imply multi-party computation. Okay. So interesting open question is whether this EFI imply one PRSG, and also whether this EFI imply one-way SG or not. So as I have said, in classical case, they are equivalent. So Goldreich showed that EFID is equal to one-way function. But in quantum case, it was open, and recently this direction was shown. But still, this direction is not clear. This one. Okay. Ah, sorry. And another question is whether we can get public key encryption from these microcrypto primitives. So classical case, even one-way function is not enough. So we need some stronger assumptions than one-way function. And here we don't know whether we can get PKE from these primitives. And also we have many other crypto primitives like certified deletion, public quantum money, copy protection, and so on. And all these primitives, the question is how they are also related to these crypto primitives. Okay, so I also explain about classical complexity assumption necessary for these primitives. So for one-way functions, quantumly secure one-way functions, necessary condition is NP is equal to BQP. Because if NP is equal to BQP, you can break quantumly secure one-way function. Because quantumly secure one-way function is in NP. So this means, so in classical case, we know this assumption. And the question is, what's a necessary complexity assumption for these microcrypto primitives? And one known result is this one. So PP is not equal to BQP is necessary for the existence of one-way puzzle. Okay. And this means all these black primitives also require PP is not equal to BQP because they imply one-way puzzle. For all these black primitives, PP is not equal to BQP is necessary. Okay, but we don't know what happened for these two red primitives, EFI and one PRSG. And only known result is this one. So Lombardi, Fermima, and John Wright showed that one PRSG exists against any one query QPT adversary that query all language. This is only one query. But they conjecture that maybe this can be extended for many queries. And in this case, if this conjecture is true, this means even if P is equal to all, still one PRSG and EFI exist. Okay. So in this case, maybe just classical complexity is not so useful to characterize quantum cryptographic primitives. So we have to introduce some new quantum complexity classes like state of BQP or unitary P space and so on. Okay. And also I explain separations. So here Kretschmann shows that even if BQP is equal to QMA, PRU exists relative to quantum local. And also this paper showed that even if P is equal to NP, relative to classical local, still this one PRCG exists. And also that result shows that even if P is equal to all, still one PRCG exists. And for example, one open question is whether we can show that PRU exists, but one-way function do not exist relative to some classical local. This is still open question. Okay, and also finally, I mentioned about QCCC primitives, which have been studied recently. So this QCCC primitive is quantum computation classical communication primitives. So locally, you can do quantum computation, but communication is only classical one. And for example, these papers showed that many QCCC primitives imply one-way puzzle or efficiently verifiable one-way puzzle. So efficiently verifiable one-way puzzle is a variant of one-way puzzle where verification is QPT. So if you remember the definition of one-way puzzle, sample algorithm is QPT, but verification algorithm is unbounded. But this EV one-way puzzle is efficiently verifiable one-way puzzle. And also, these papers showed that log output PRSG imply many QCCC primitives. So log output PRSG is PRSG with log output qubit. So output quantum state is log qubit. And because this is log, you can do efficient tomography to get classical description of this quantum state, because this is log qubit. And now what you get is something like quantum evaluation PRG. So input and output are classical data, but the evaluation is quantum. So somehow you get something like quantum evaluation PRG. And once you get this PRG, from that you can construct PRF or digital signature, for example. Or you can get a commitment. Because in classical case, we know that we can get these primitives from PRG. Okay. So technically, there are something that you have to work more, but intuitively, just you can do the same thing in classical case. So in this way, you can get a QCCC primitive from log output PRSG. But however, this log output PRSG seems to be different from this PRU people. So they imply QCCC primitives. And QCC primitives imply one-way puzzle, EV one-way puzzle, or one-way puzzle. Okay? But actually, you can easily see that, so Kretschmann showed that PRU exists, even if BQP is equal to QMA. So all these primitives exist, even if BQP is equal to QMA. But on the other hand, you can easily see that they are broken by QCMA oracle. So this means they don't exist if BQP is equal to QCMA. So because this is a classical communication, so adversary can take this classical data, and this adversary can send this classical data to QCMA oracle. So in quantum case, you cannot do that because quantum state cannot be sent to the oracle. Okay? But in this case, you can do that. So they are easily broken by QCMA oracle. So this means they are separated. So especially, we will not be able to construct QCCC primitives from PRU. And also, we will not be able to construct log output PRSG from PRSG. So this means PRG cannot be shrinked. So in classical case, PRG can be shrinked. So if you have some PRG, just you can discard some of output. And of course, your output length is shrinked, trivially. But in quantum case, you cannot do that because output is entangled. And this shows that you cannot shrink the output of PRG, PRSG, unlike classical case. Okay, so this is a summary of my talk. So in summary, in quantum case, we have new world. And in this new world, we have new primitives, quantum primitives. And they are weaker than one-way functions, but still they have many applications. And this is just a reference. So maybe this slide is public data, so you can see this reference. Thank you very much for your attention.
Are there questions for Tomoyuki? If you have, we have mics so people online can hear them. Maybe I can start while we can find people. So you mentioned about this this conjecture about random unitaries, random circuits being good PRUs.
Mm.
And you said that we don't have a proof for that.
Yeah, yeah.
But do you expect a proof from that? Like we don't have a proof that LWE is a one-way function, right?
Yeah, I don't know. But so intuitively, this is clear that this random circuit will not imply one-way function because so in one-way function, you get classical data and you have to invert, but there is no such classical data. So
my question is, okay, at least I don't expect a proof that the random circuit is a PRU, but we have some belief that this is the case, as in the sense that we believe that LWE is a one-way function. So how can we be convinced that this is a good assumption?
Yeah, I don't know, just the folklore says that. So just on the other hand, I want to ask why you think a random circuit is not a PRU? Why you think random circuit is not a PRU?
No, I think it is. I mean, the point is just that how can we start having this as a good assumption? That is my question.
Okay, yeah, I don't know.
So thanks for your talk. I have a very basic question. So what's the difference between QCCC and LOCC? Like why do you have to extra assumption for QC?
Assumption. Yeah, so just this QCCC was so this QCCC name was introduced by this paper, CGG, and just they say this is QCCC. But the situation is just LOCC, so locally quantum and classical communication.
So no difference, basically.
Yeah, yeah, basically, just the name.
Okay, thanks.
But usually LOCC was studied in the context of statistical security. So results in LOCC not necessarily applied here. Because here we have some computational assumption. But essentially just they are the same.
At some point you had a claim that two, I think, PRUs, and I don't remember what the other primitive was, that those are not equivalent based on a relativizing proof. If I think another slide back.
Do you mean this QCC one?
Yeah, I think some. I don't recall which it was, but the argument was that they're relative to some oracle, these two things are not equivalent. And my question was that, for example, in the P versus NP question, we know that relativizing proofs don't suffice. So how would such a relativizing argument be sufficient here?
Yeah, so that's true. So just we don't know any other technique to show that. And even situation is worse here because, so here, for example, we use quantum oracle instead of classical oracle, which is worse than classical oracle. And also sometimes we introduce isometry oracle, so not unitary oracle. So in this way, there are many problems here, but just this type of research has started very recently. And what we can do is only this type of very limited one.
Okay, so this means that this, it's not a rigorous argument in the sense because of this relativizing proof, we know they are not equivalent. It's more like a hint that because of this relativizing proof, they may not be equivalent.
Yeah, at least, for example, you can prohibit some specific type of black box construction. So, for example, okay, so here, for example, they use isometry oracle that output some Hall random state. And this means from this, you cannot construct this. If just you use, if you run this and you get output, and if you just use this output state, you cannot construct this one. So at least this type of trivial, how to say, very simple construction is not, is impossible.
Okay, thank you.
More questions? Okay, there's one here.
Sorry, maybe I just have a basic question. In the 23 page.
23.
You said that the statistical security is impossible or unknown for many primitive, even in Q-crypto. I didn't fully understand this sentence because later you said that you said something about the digital signatures and commitments. So, but these are computational security, so I didn't follow you here. Could you please explain more?
Yeah. So for example, here, digital signature, if adversary is unbounded, adversary can always forge signature.
So I just didn't understand why it is related to the statistical security. So why you say that statistical security is impossible?
So adversary is not, is if adversary is unbounded, adversary can break digital signature. So this means statistical security is not guaranteed.
Okay, thank you.
More questions? Well, if not, let's thank Tomoyuki again.